Hello, all. Welcome to the Silicon Valley Health Institute. We're a nonprofit organization, and we want to bring you some of the world's leading experts for health information so we can be proactive in our health and go on a path toward optimal wellness. We're currently having weekly Zoom meetings as we're a nonprofit. Donations are good. You make sure you're on our email list. You can just go to email our website at svhi.com. And anyway, my name is Susan Downs, and this gentleman here in the blue shirt is Stephen Fox, who's extremely smart. And our guest today is Darin Ingels, who is a naturopath and very well respected in that area, numerous publications. I've read his book on Lyme disease. It's very interesting, holistic, and integrative. He's got 30 years experience in the healthcare field, received his Bachelor of Science in Medical Technology from the Purdue University and his Doctorate of Naturopathic Medicine from Bastyr University in Seattle. He completed his residency at Bastyr Center for Natural Health. He's a licensed naturopathic physician in the state of Connecticut and a licensed doctor of naturopathic medicine in California as well, where he maintains practices in both states. He's also board certified in integrated pediatrics through the American Association of Integrative Medicine and is a fellow in the American Academy of Environmental Medicine. He's published extensively and he's written a book, The Natural Pharmacist, The Lowering Cholesterol and Natural Treatments for High Cholesterol. He's written an allergy desensitization for autistic children and cutting age therapies for autism. And he's the author of the book, The Lyme Solution, a 5-part plan to fight the inflammatory autoimmune response and beat Lyme disease. And welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Our pleasure.
How about starting off with a brief summary of your Lyme insights?
Sure. Well, you know, it's so interesting. So, you know, I'm a Lyme patient as much as I'm a Lyme doctor. Like a lot of us, you know, we get into these areas of medicine because we get our own sort of our afflictions. And I was literally 2 weeks before opening my own practice in Connecticut, and I got bit by a tick. And I had every classic symptom that you read about with Lyme disease. I had 105 fever, joint pain, I had tingling, neuropathy, a migraine headache, and a big bullseye rash on the back of my left leg. So I treated it right away. And within really 4 days of doxycycline, I felt completely well. And if any of you know what it's like when you open your own business, you know, you do everything. So I was the doctor, the receptionist, the bookkeeper, you know, kind of handling all the duties. So I was working 6-7 days a week, you know, 10, 12 hour days. And 8 months into that schedule, I started to relapse. I started getting headaches again. I started getting joint pain. The neuropathy came back. And I recognized pretty quickly what was going on. And this is now February in Connecticut, where it's cold and there's snow on the ground. So I was pretty sure it wasn't a new tick bite. And I said, okay, well, you know, I went on antibiotics before, I'll do it again. So I went back on doxycycline and I was on it for a month and it did nothing. Then I switched to azithromycin, went on for another month, it did nothing. Then I went through another 6-7 months of changing, you know, different combinations of antibiotics. I'd been working with another local Lyme doctor who was well-respected. And, you know, 8 months, 9 months into various antibiotic regimens, I was only getting worse. You know, I was getting all the side effects. I was nauseous all the time. I lost 30 pounds in the course of that 6 months. My gut was a wreck. And, you know, it was very apparent that that was really not doing the job. I was fortunate to have known of a doctor in New York City named Dr. Zhang. He's a Chinese medical doctor and works as an acupuncturist in Manhattan. And I had seen patients over the years that had seen him and had done quite well. So I went to see him and, you know, he kind of, you know, shined the light that, you know, I wasn't really adhering to what I was telling my own patients to do, certainly as a naturopathic doctor, you know, in terms of getting good sleep and eating good food and taking care of yourself. So he, you know, kicked my butt and gave me that reminder and then started me on some Chinese herbal formulas. And in about a month's time, I was 80-85% improved. So, you know, I started really taking stock of my own health. Again, just eating better foods, sleeping more, not working as much. And it still took another 2 years, I think, till I felt like I really got my mojo back, but eventually got to a point where I was living symptom-free. So I just really started applying what I was doing for myself to my patients. And of course, being in, you know, Lyme Central of Connecticut, you know, we had lots and lots of people to take care of. And I found that when I started treating Lyme really more like an autoimmune problem than just a straight up infection, you know, people started getting better faster. That's really kind of what prompted me to write my book. But again, it's really my own experience. And now it's, you know, almost 20 years later, and I've treated over 7,000 Lyme patients. So I've, you know, been able to see what happens when people really kind of apply these, you know, very fundamental principles, which I think really gets to the essence of functional medicine, right? That we're trying to get to root cause medicine and figure out why people, you know, end up with these chronic issues. So I end up relocating out here to California. I actually grew up in Southern California. I grew up in Rancho Cucamonga. So, you know, coming back to me was sort of coming home. But I moved back here 2 years ago and I was gobsmacked, I think that's the English term, of the number of doctors here that were completely ignorant to Lyme disease. They would tell patients either A, there is no Lyme disease in California, which is ludicrous. You know, there's no possible way they could have gotten it here. Just all these ridiculous statements. And yet the CDC, if you go to their website, will tell you that California is the fifth fastest growing state for Lyme disease in the country. And if you look at the map of where you find deer ticks, they are literally up and down the East and West Coast. And you'll see now it's pushing in towards the central part of the US. You know, we have Lyme disease reported in all 50 states, including Hawaii and Alaska. And, you know, people do this little thing called traveling too. So even if they didn't acquire it in California per se, you know, maybe they went camping somewhere, maybe they were on vacation. So, you know, it's possible their exposure came outside of California. But I've had patients who are born and raised in California, really haven't left the state, who've contracted Lyme disease. Those of you guys up in the Bay Area, you are at higher risk than those of us in Southern California. You've got more furry little wooded creatures up there than I guess we do down here. The incidence of Lyme in the Bay Area is much greater than Southern California, but it really is up and down the entire state. So I think, you know, part of my message to you today is just that awareness that, you know, Lyme is a, I'll say, relatively common problem. And, you know, I think to highlight, you know, the things that raise the red flags for me, you know, when you get someone coming in or, you know, someone you're working with that's got this compilation of mysterious neurological and arthritic symptoms, that should be a big red flag for some sort of tick-borne illness. Because if you look at all the other diseases out there, there are very few things that cause that combination of neurological and, you know, arthritic issues. And whether it's Lyme disease, Bartonella, Babesia, Anaplasma, you know, every time I go to ILADS or some other Lyme conference, I swear we learn there's, you know, another 10 things that ticks carry that we have to worry about and test for. That list keeps growing. I mean, there's lots and lots of stuff that ticks can carry. But, you know, Lyme is really one of the more prominent ones. And so, you know, when someone comes in, you know, with, you know, longstanding migraines, my knee hurts, you know, the two symptoms that are really the most common is migratory joint pain. There's no arthritic condition in the world that causes migratory joint pain other than Lyme disease. If you guys have ever heard Dr. Richard Horowitz talk, you know, he's really the guru out there on Lyme disease. And, you know, when you go through and you look at all the medical literature, there's nothing out there that describes migratory joint pain outside of Lyme disease. If you've got rheumatoid arthritis, Reiter's syndrome, ankylosing spondylitis, you name it, you know, it's the same joint. It's consistent. Now, the intensity and the duration of the pain may vary, but you don't hear about my right shoulder, then my left knee, then my right ankle, then my left pinky, and so forth. Though that is very much stereotypical for Lyme disease. So the migratory joint pain and that bullseye rash. The bullseye rash, again, is pathognomonic for Lyme disease. There's nothing else that causes that. I probably get at least one or two pictures sent to me a month of someone who thinks they have a bullseye rash. Unfortunately, there are other rashes that sometimes look like that target, that erythema migrans rash. And sometimes it's just a histamine reaction from a mosquito bite. And sometimes you'll see a little central clearing that might look like a bullseye rash. So if it's true bullseye rash, you know, the ticks have an anesthetic in their little jaws. So when they bite you, you can't feel it. you know, mosquito bites, ant bites, horse flies, usually people feel when they get bit by these insects, where tick bites people don't feel. An erythema migrans rash is flat, where, you know, mosquito bites, insect bite, spider bites tend to be red, raised, kind of angry looking. So flat rashes that don't itch and that start to spread. That's a very stereotypical Lyme rash. It may not look necessarily like that bullseye or target, but when you see that flat spreading rash, again, you know, if it's a histamine reaction, that tends to dissipate within 1 to 2 days. If it's a mosquito bite, it'll itch, it's raised, it's red, 1 or 2 days it goes away, pretty good chance it's not a Lyme rash. So, you know, again, if you start to see these kind of weird rashes, you know, come into your practices, that would certainly be a red flag that there may be some element of Lyme. And, you know, these ticks carry other things than Lyme. I think, you know, we tend to think a lot about Lyme disease because it's probably one of the more common tick-borne illnesses. But I'm seeing more and more people with Lyme plus Bartonella, Babesia, Anaplasma. We had an interesting experience a few years back down here in Orange County. We had a series of patients that tested positive for Anaplasma, which is not generally considered to be, you know, much of a problem here in California. That you do see more out in the Midwest. And we had like, I don't know, 10 or 12 patients that tested positive for Anaplasma. Now they had symptoms, but the Orange County Department of Public Health called us and basically yelled at us and said, stop using this lab. You keep getting positives. I'm like, well, I'm sorry, but our patients are symptomatic and we're testing them. And that's what we do. So whether there was an issue with the test itself, I don't think so. I think for whatever reason, there was a little, you know, run of Anaplasma and whatever, you know, ticks were out there that were affecting people. And since then, we don't see as many Anaplasma cases. But, you know, I think it's important that, you know, when you're evaluating your patients, that you're really looking at the wide gamut of, you know, all the different things that these ticks can transmit. And, you know, you don't necessarily have to be a camper, a hiker. You know, certainly when I lived in Connecticut, I mean, I was not an outdoorsy person. I probably acquired my tick through my dog because the dog would go outdoors, do its business, then come inside. If the tick was on the dog, then the tick's now the dog's on your lap. Tick can, you know, migrate off the dog onto you. So, you know, people can get exposed, you know, walking to their car, walking through their own grass. You know, these ticks are teeny weeny tiny. If you haven't had a lot of experience looking at ticks, go check them out online because they are really small. You know, unlike a dog tick or wood tick that usually you can see pretty easily with the bare eye, these deer ticks are about the size of a poppy seed. And even a fully engorged deer tick is, you know, slightly bigger than that. You know, I remember having a tick on my arm when I was actually in treatment. I'd already started doxycycline for Lyme disease. I saw this little speck on my forearm. I thought it was just dirt and I went to flick it and it moved. And I had to go grab my magnifying glass and I saw it had little legs on it. And I'm like, oh shoot, now that's another, you know, deer tick. And it was a nymph, it was tiny. So I got my tweezers and pulled it off before it had a chance to attach. But again, these ticks can be very, very difficult to identify. So if you've got people who spend a lot of time outdoors, it's a really good idea to start educating them on wearing protective gear when they go outside, especially if they're going to be camping, hiking, doing that kind of outdoor activity. Long pants, long sleeve shirts, hat if there's going to be overhanging foliage like tree branches and they're going to be going through that. And then using some sort of natural tick repellent. So, you know, you don't have to use DEET, which is horribly toxic. There's a lot of research that various essential oils are effective at repelling ticks. So things like cedar oil, thuya oil, lemon balm oil, tea tree oil. You know, if you look at a lot of these natural products, you'll see it's usually a combination of various essential oils. And I find they're actually quite effective. And the nice thing is they're safe, even if they apply it directly to their skin. Usually I just recommend that people just apply it to the outer part of their clothing, especially the low-lying areas like their shoes, lower part of their pant leg. That's probably the greatest risk where they might come in contact with ticks. Again, unless they're going to be going through, you know, areas where there's a lot of scrub brush, then they might want to do a little extra on their arms or their hat. Safe for children. So again, if your kids are going to be outdoors playing and you're concerned about that, you can always put it directly on the skin. All these essential oils are diluted in a carry oil. So, you know, please don't go buy straight essential oil and put it directly on the skin. It'll burn. doesn't feel good at all. But again, a lot of these pre-made ones, I use one called TikTok Naturals. It's a very nice combination, and you can find it all over the internet. But you know, if you go to Whole Foods or any natural health food store, you'll probably find some of their variation. Again, I think a lot of them are similar combinations of the various essential oils. So that's a really great way just to educate your folks about, you know, protecting themselves when outdoors. For little kids in particular, when they come indoors, strip them down naked, do tick checks. Ticks like the dark, moist areas of the body, behind the knees, in the armpit, in the groin, behind the ears, in the hairline. I had one patient that we kind of pulled through their hair. I was suspicious they had Lyme, and I saw a big bullseye. It was in their head. I mean, I had to like pull their hair apart to see the rings. It was very difficult, but they got bit on their head, and that's, they had a rash. It just, you know, their hair was covering it. I don't recommend people shave their head to prove that, but just to point out that, you know, these ticks do like to go to the warm, moist areas of the body. And so you just want to double check that for yourself and as much as you can for your kids. So, you know, how do you know someone has Lyme disease? Well, I mentioned, you know, that compilation of neurologic and arthritic symptoms, but I sort of break it down into what I call acute Lyme disease and chronic Lyme disease. Acute Lyme disease, generally, these are people who are sick. And I hardly see any of these people anymore. I think when those people are in that state, you know, either they're running to the ER because they're really, really sick, or maybe they're going to their primary care doctor, and I'm not a primary care doctor. So I don't see a lot of those folks. But think about, you know, high fever, splitting headaches, often presents as a migraine headache, joint pain, maybe the migratory joint pain. Neuropathy is common, numbness and tingling, especially in the hands and the feet. Bell's palsy is common, swollen lymph nodes, sore throat, fever, chills. You know, these folks look acutely ill. And on the surface, it would look like a lot of other acute illnesses. And, you know, then it's just through your history, your differential diagnosis, and through some lab testing, you'd figure out, you know, is it, you know, if you have a high fever, it's probably not viral. Viruses don't typically cause high fever like that. Probably bacterial. But again, when you start to hear about the neuropathy, you hear about the joint pain, again, that should raise some red flags that it may be some sort of tick-borne illness. Because typically, if someone's got bronchitis or sinusitis, you know, they'll get more localized effects. But when you hear about systemic effects, and of course, unless you're suspicious of septicemia for any other reason, it's just odd that someone would randomly become septic without having some sort of puncture wound or post-surgical event. So that's probably not as likely in the history, but those are sort of the symptoms that we see acutely. And if people miss that window of getting diagnosed early, then we'll see this sort of morph into what I call chronic Lyme. And although you can have a lot of the hallmarks of acute Lyme and some of the same symptoms, as it moves into a more chronic phase, we'll see more neurological symptoms. So we'll start to see balance problems, coordination issues, cognitive impairment, memory loss. You know, it can look a lot like now sorts of all sorts of other various neurological issues. You can still get the joint pain, you get chronic fatigue, sleep disturbances, hormone imbalances. Hypothyroidism following Lyme is extremely common. Sometimes you'll see it trickle down into adrenal problems or even reproductive hormone issues. So hormone imbalances are very common. Other metabolic issues, blood sugar dysregulation, POTS is very common, mast cell issues. You know, I think as we, that organism stays in the body longer, again, it morphs out of being really an infection and all the immune activation that happens in the ability to fight infection. And then that changes more sort of a Th1 response to a Th2 response that drives more autoimmunity. And again, if you look in the medical literature, we've got several studies that show that Borrelia specifically can cause a cross reaction with the white matter of the brain and the peripheral nerves. So we can get, again, a lot of these neurological issues. We know it targets different proteins in the joints. That's why we get some of this chronic joint pain. So at that point, killing the bug by itself may not be enough to really get people well. So if you think about it, you know, how do you approach autoimmune disease? Well, now it's everything else that, you know, we have to do to get the body functioning at a higher level. So, you know, it's not just about killing the bug anymore. And as with regards to antibiotics, you know, look, I'm a naturopathic doctor. I try to avoid antibiotics as much as possible. I think in acute Lyme disease, antibiotics are very appropriate. and I would use them. Now, I will also tell you, I do have patients with acute Lyme disease, and we elect to use herbs. I think herbs are extremely potent, and you may or may not have any training in herbal medicine, so that might be meaningful to you or not, might not be. I would say if it's not in your bag of tricks, you should learn about it, because it's incredibly helpful, and the side effect profile is much better than using antibiotics. So for acute Lyme disease, you know, you really have the option of using antibiotics. And, you know, the CDC recommendation is, 14 to 21 days of doxycycline and or amoxicillin. And if you believe someone has neurological Lyme, then it's IV rocephin. The IDSA, the Infectious Disease Society of America, and the CDC have been revamping those guidelines. I don't know that it's been finalized yet, but it looks like the new recommendations are going to shorten that course of antibiotics to probably 7 to 10 days. And to point out how completely stupid that is, think about this. If you have somebody who's got tuberculosis, you know, the standard treatment, even by the CDC, is, you know, a triple antibiotic cocktail for 9 to 12 months. That is the recommended dose for, or that's recommended, you know, a course of action for tuberculosis. Why do we do such a long course of treatment? Well, tuberculosis, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, or tuberculum, is an extremely slow growing organism. And considering that most bacteria in your body replicate about every 10 minutes, tuberculosis replicates every 15 to 20 days, or excuse me, 20 hours. So that's extremely slow. Well, to put that in perspective, Borrelia replicates every 1 to 16 days, which is much slower. So why we're willing to give a patient with tuberculosis 3 antibiotics for up to a year, but we want to give a Lyme patient, you know, 1 antibiotic for 7 to 10 days, makes no biological sense. And, you know, we've been kind of at war with the IDSA for years over, you know, proper treatment of Lyme disease. And although I think we all appreciate, you know, over-treatment with antibiotics, because we all recognize that there's a potential downside to being on antibiotics, there's also a potential downside with chronic Lyme disease. So again, I think if you've got those acute patients and you're going to elect using antibiotics, 6 weeks is the minimum. 6 weeks is the minimum based on the recommendations from ILADS. I would agree with that. Based on the life cycle of the organism, we want to give those antibiotics enough time to actually eradicate the organism so it doesn't persist and go on to cause further problems down the line. Again, if you're going to elect to use herbs, it's also at least 6 weeks. Most of my patients on herbs are usually on for at least 2 months, but you know, that's really kind of what you feel most comfortable with. I think the question gets asked a lot about, well, what about that person that finds the tick on them? Like today, they pulled the tick off. What do I do? Well, if you have a patient who's lucky enough to find that tick, A, you want them to save the tick, and you want to send the tick to a lab that can actually test the tick directly and find out the tick is even carrying anything. So you can send it to tickreport.com. and just have them save the tick, put in a little plastic Ziploc baggie with a damp, moist cotton ball that just keeps the tick from drying out. And then they can download all the information from tickreport.com and then mail the tick off. You get a report back in 72 hours. So it's a quick turnaround time. So it just gives you better information about what you want to do. Medical Diagnostic Labs in Hamilton, New Jersey also will test the tick. Their turnaround times, I think, 48 to 72 hours. So with either lab, I think cost is pretty close. Tickreport.com might be a little bit cheaper, but I've used both labs. They're both great. But I think getting the tick tested is helpful. While you're waiting for that report, my feeling is if you know, or if they know it's a deer tick. Now, again, sometimes it's a dog tick, a wood tick, something else. If they really don't know, they didn't take a picture of the tick, they can't show you, and you don't know, my feeling is treat until proven otherwise. You know, there is a lot of benefit of treating early. You know, you're reducing the risk of this becoming anything persistent the sooner someone gets treatment. So my feeling is treat until proven otherwise. Now, the standard testing for Lyme, unfortunately, is antibody testing, and it can take up to a month to make antibodies. So if someone pulls the tick off today and you want to test them, testing them today or tomorrow may not be appropriate, just because if you do the test and it's negative, it may not mean that it's truly negative. It just may mean that they haven't had enough time to elicit a strong enough antibody response to pick up on a blood test. So we have to give the patient time to have that immune response. it is possible with antibiotics to a certain degree, you can suppress that immune response. It is also possible when you look at the research that that initial treatment with doxycycline may also suppress the rash. So if someone, you know, pulls that tick off, they don't see a rash right away. And if you started treatment right away, particularly with antibiotics, that rash may never come. Now, the CDC says that up to 80% of the people who get infected with Lyme get that rash. If you look at the research, it suggests it's less than 50%. And those of us who've been in the field a long time will probably tell you it's less than 20%. It's actually not that common. So it's kind of a gift if you get someone who has that rash, because again, nothing else causes it. In reality, it's not a reliable marker about whether someone has or has not been exposed to Lyme disease. So if you see it, great, but don't count on it. And again, I hardly ever see anyone. I mean, in the last, I'll say maybe 3 years, I've had two people that had a rash. So it's really not that common, especially here in California. So again, if you see that, you know, starting treatment right away until proven otherwise. Now, I will generally treat until I get a copy of the tick report back. If the tick comes back clean, of course, nothing's perfect, but I will feel a lot more confident about shortening their course of treatment. So it may mean by the time I get their tick report back, if they're completely asymptomatic, we may stop their treatment completely. We may say, you know what, the tick report might not be 100% accurate. Let's have you go on for 2 or 3 weeks, see how you feel. At that point, we're going to do your blood test, give your immune system enough chance to actually make antibodies, at which point now we can test you, see if there actually has been exposure in your body. But if the tick report comes back completely clean, you test your patient, they've got no antibodies at all, then I think you could feel pretty safe that they probably didn't have that exposure. And at that point, you can just tell them, you know, just to monitor themselves in case something comes out later. But the odds are actually probably pretty low. If you have someone that has a positive tick, even if their antibody test is negative, and again, especially if that's early, I would probably still treat longer term, just because we know the tick was infected. The patient may not have the appropriate immune response to make antibodies. I don't want to guess, and I don't want to wait to find out, because again, by the time we find out, it might be already, you know, causing problems with their joints, their neurological system, and I don't really want to take that chance. So I would prefer to, you know, treat during that 6 weeks and just ensure that we've covered the bases. And of course, if you've got someone, you know, who the tick's positive, you do the blood test on them, it's positive, well, then it's a hands down slam dunk. You know, you need to treat them. And now it's just a function of treating them until you feel confident that they are well. You will have some patients where you treat them and yeah, within a handful of days or weeks, they actually feel quite well. I would not stop the treatment at that point. I would still do 6 weeks to really knock it down, because I've seen people that do the shorter treatment, they feel better temporarily, and temporarily could be months, maybe even a year. And then somewhere down the road, then they start having a relapse of symptoms again, which as far as we can tell was not a new tick bite. So I'd rather, you know, go that extra course. I think there's a lot we can do to help protect our patient's gut while they're on antibiotics or even on herbal therapy. So I'm less concerned about that, much more concerned about any perspective of, you know, long-term Lyme or other tick-borne illness, because that can cause much more damaging effects on the joints and the neurological system.
Can I ask if there's a decision that you make regarding the differential between, let's say, oral use of antibiotics with the potentially larger adverse effect on the gut microbiome versus intravenous, as to which way you would necessarily go with that?
Yeah, so the decision between oral and IV antibiotics, so IV antibiotics are still going to kill off your gut flora. It's not going to make any difference from that standpoint. You know, you'll get enough of the drug through the bloodstream, through the gut, that it'll still wipe out your normal gut flora. I think the issue is really more about how their symptoms present. IV antibiotics for me is really where the primary problems are neurological. And, you know, when these patients really start to look like MS, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, because there's a strong correlation between Lyme and multiple sclerosis. But when they start having those kind of symptoms, you know, balance problems, coordination issues, cognitive impairment, memory issues, that's a big red flag for me that IV antibiotics are probably going to be the better way to go. Now, again, if you look at the research, that's for acute Lyme disease. When you get into that chronic state, and it's a fine line between what's acute, what's chronic. I'd say it's probably somewhere in that 3 to 6 month range where it transitions over. Although some research came out, I want to say late last year, maybe it was the very beginning of this year, you know, with COVID-19, the whole like space time continuum ceased to exist. So I'm forgetting the timeline, but they showed that there is a smaller population of people that when they get bitten by a tick, they go right into chronic Lyme disease. And the reason is that they are already infected with a certain percentage, and can be up to 20% of these Borrelia that are resistant to antibiotics. So they call these persister cells, and these persister cells are there from the get-go. And so even though they have, quote, acute Lyme disease, they will present almost already like a chronic Lyme patient, because they'll start off already having all these neurological symptoms, much more than the average Lyme patient that might take some time to progress to that. So if someone comes in, they've got all these neurological symptoms, and as far as you can tell, their exposure was maybe within 3 to 6 months, you know, it might be worth considering IV, you know, Rocephin. You can use other IV antibiotics. You know, IV Rocephin's what the CDC recommends, but if they're allergic, you know, to penicillins or the cephalosporin group, you know, you can use doxycycline, you can use azithromycin, you can use ceftriaxone, you can use ceftazidime. There's a lot of them. It's just kind of, you know, what insurance covers, you know, what your patient tolerates. But it's still going to be, I think, you know, if you've got them on the IV antibiotic regimen, I would still do that 4 to 6 week regimen to, you know, see the course out and see how they respond to it. So, yeah, the decision for me is really based on their presentation more than whether I'm worried about it affecting their gut or not.
People with autoimmune tendencies or actual diagnoses, are they more or less at risk, or do you treat them differently as a subpopulation?
Someone who already has an autoimmune disease, if they get infected with Lyme? Yeah, I think they're already disposed. I think, you know, the scales have already tipped in that, you know, that balance between their Th1 and Th2 pathway. Now, some autoimmune diseases are Th1 driven, you know, like rheumatoid arthritis. Most of them are Th2 driven. So if you've got lupus, PMR, Sjogren's, scleroderma, a lot of those are Th2. So if they're Th2 imbalanced already, that disposition for Borrelia to just be one more trigger is already there. So I can't say that I've seen a lot of patients with pre-existing autoimmune disease that then got Lyme disease. I kind of see it the other way around. Most of my patients were pretty well. They got Lyme disease, and then they developed some sort of autoimmune problem down the line. But yeah, in theory, if someone already has a pre-existing autoimmune condition, they get exposed. I think it's like throwing gas on the fire. It just potentially makes that inflammatory process much worse.
How about what you learned about Lyme treatment as it might apply to other kinds of conditions that are prevalent?
Other kind of conditions such as?
Oh, infections, Th1, Th2 imbalances, COVID, toxicities.
Sure. Well, you know, what I learned about treating Lyme, particularly in its chronic phase stage, is that you have to treat the whole person. And it's really about getting the person healthy. So this applies to everything. You know, yeah, COVID-19, you know, funny, I don't know about you guys. I mean, I've had one COVID-19 patient in my practice, one. You know, this is a population in Orange County of 3.2 million people. And I've had one person. I don't see all 3.2 million, but I mean, I think our patients are so much better prepared against COVID-19 because we're doing so many other things to get them well. And between, you know, the vitamins, their diet, the herbs they take, they got so many protective mechanisms against COVID-19. My one patient was an uncontrolled diabetic who lived on fast food. He was a new patient to me. And we were just starting to work on all this when he got infected. And we actually did the azithromycin, hydroxychloroquine, zinc combination, worked beautifully for him. He was well within a week. And that was my one. So I think, you know, again, fundamentally, you know, as we're working on getting people well, and, you know, what I kind of outline in my book, which was written for patients, is like, look, you know, you got to start with the gut. You know, if you don't have a good gut, you're not going to have a good immune system. You know, up to 80% of your immune function stems from the gut. So these patients with chronic, you know, constipation, diarrhea, gas, bloating, you know, whatever it is, SIBO, all that is a disruption ultimately to their immune system. So it's sitting down and looking at, you know, are there underlying issues to their gut? Do they have a chronic gut infection? Do they have, you know, some sort of inflammatory bowel disease like, you know, ulcerative colitis or Crohn's or IBS? Are they a celiac patient? You know, we have to look at all those gut issues, and that's where I start. I mean, you know, we kind of talk about with Lyme, but I always start looking at the gut first, and whether we're doing stool testing or, you know, SIBO breath testing, H. pylori breath testing, I like to kind of know from top to bottom what's going on in someone's gut so that we're implementing the right treatments, because we can spin our wheels doing all this other stuff. And if their gut isn't right, it's like pissing in the wind. It just doesn't work the way it's supposed to. So we do a lot to help get their gut balance, get their gut ecology balanced, and make sure that they're having good, healthy eliminations, you know, once or twice a day, at least, you know, good stooling, good color, all that stuff. You know, beyond that, you know, then it's about diet. You know, I mean, I think a lot of people at least coming to see a naturopath already have a heads up that we're probably going to talk about their diet. And we spend a lot of time, you know, educating them about what they should be eating, what they shouldn't be eating. Sometimes we'll go a little bit deeper, get into food allergy, food sensitivity testing. I think it's really helpful so that people know exactly what's working against them. If you want to talk about more of that later, we can. But I think, you know, just that fundamental principle of, you know, eating clean food, eating organic food when possible. I'm actually in favor of what, you know, has been out there for a long time, an alkaline diet. And it's funny, when I wrote my book, I was trying to do all the research out there, and I was actually shocked how little research was actually out there on an alkaline diet. If you go into PubMed and type in alkaline diet, you'll laugh. There's like three articles. But I was talking to Deanna Minnick, you know, if you know her, she teaches for IFM and she's a PhD nutritionist. And she's like, oh no, you can't look for alkaline diet. You have to look at net acid loss. Apparently that's how it gets classified in research, is I think net acid loss, if I'm remembering correctly. So it's about, it's the same thing, is that, you know, when you're eating certain foods, as they break down in your body, either they break down to become acid, break down to become alkaline, or, you know, they're relatively neutral. So we really want foods that are really more alkaline, because it does alter cellular pH. You know, outside of your skin, stomach, bladder, and for women, the vaginal area, which are highly acidic to protect against outside invaders, the rest of your body and your cells more or less is alkaline. So as we eat foods that break down to be alkaline producing, that inherently starts making our cells more alkaline. So when you look at the research that has been done, we find it helps facilitate cellular repair, helps reduce inflammation, helps with bone growth, actually specifically helps with multiple sclerosis. So we know that it metabolically, it's shifting the body in the right direction. So what I did is I kind of broke it down. And it's funny, because every time I read different sources on what foods are alkaline, which ones are acid, which ones are neutral, there was a lot of misinformation between sources. So I kind of had to grab from a bunch of sources and sort it out. But more or less, you know, most plants tend to be very alkaline forming. So people who are a vegetarian, vegan, you know, eating a lot of plants in their diet are probably going to be mostly alkaline, just because most plants break down that way. People who are highly carnivorous, you know, meats, animal proteins do tend to be mildly acidic. And if you're eating a lot of it, there is a cumulative effect. So the way I break it down is that, you know, eating mostly plant-based diet, limiting your animal proteins and eggs down to about 20-25% of your diet for the week. And then, you know, a lot of fruit tends to be, you know, either neutral or slightly acidic. So kind of, again, kind of limiting your fruit intake, and then eliminating all the junk food, all the processed food, getting dairy and gluten out of the diet, because they cause problems for so many people anyway. And then, you know, getting rid of just highly acidic foods, and which for most people actually ends up being coffee. You know, a lot of our Lyme patients are really fatigued. They use coffee as a pick-me-up. And unfortunately, coffee is very acid-producing in the body. So it's interesting. When I first had Lyme, I was a big coffee drinker. And I would find that I would drink a sip of coffee and my neuropathy would flare within minutes. And I tried this, you know, multiple times to see if that was really happening. And yep, every time, one, two sips of coffee, 5-10 minutes later, my neuropathy would just flare. So I had to cut coffee out. So, you know, I like it because it's a nutrient-dense diet. I think this is the way our true paleo forefathers probably actually ate. You know, we foraged off the ground and we killed when we could, but it probably wasn't every day. So we had some animal protein. It just wasn't the bulk of our diet. And of course, we didn't eat any processed food. So for those who really subscribe to a paleo diet, I think this is closer to the true paleo diet, because a lot of my patients come in like, well, what do you eat? Well, I follow a paleo diet. Well, what do you eat? Well, I eat 2 pounds of beef a day and 2 turkey legs. They're eating so much animal protein. And when we test their urine pH, they're highly acidic. And if you've been following the literature on this, there's pretty good evidence it's actually creating early kidney disease. And I've seen a handful of patients now who are very young that are in stage 1 kidney disease. You know, their GFR is getting down below 60. And that's not healthy either. So I'm a little bit concerned that high animal protein intake is, you know, causing early kidney issues. So anyway, this kind of avoids that. People feel satiated. They get all the right nutrients they need, and it's sustainable. I know some people are a big fan of ketogenic diet. I've got nothing against ketogenic diet. The reality is most patients won't follow through with it. They're good for usually 2 or 3 weeks. And then they're like, you know, I'm done. And I don't get a fight when people are on alkaline diet. So if you have people who can commit to keto diet, I think keto diet's great. I think it helps a lot of people, at least in the short term. But an alkaline diet to me is a long-term sustainable diet. So that's sort of, you know, the step two. You know, we got their gut in better working order. Step two is we really work on their diet, make sure they're eating good, clean food, and we're moving their pH. And again, you can ask your patients to check their urine pH. You know, pH strips you can buy at any pharmacy. I try and get their urine pH 7.2 or higher. Even if they're completely alkaline, you'll hardly ever see their urine pH higher than 8. So, you know, first morning urine is always concentrated. It's always going to be acidic just because you make ketone bodies from fasting. Those are acids. So testing first morning urine isn't very helpful. But, you know, 30 minutes after they have a meal, have them go pee on the strip, see where their urine pH is. And that'll give you a pretty good idea about if they're, you know, between what they're doing diet-wise, any, you know, supplements you've recommended, herbs. You can kind of see what the combination of everything they're putting in their mouth is doing to their metabolism. And again, just a really inexpensive, easy way to help monitor your folks and making sure they're on task. Step three for me is now targeting the organism. So now we got the gut in good working order. We're working on their diet. Now we can start going after the bug. And this is where, again, it kind of comes down to personal preference. You know, do you want to use antibiotics? Do you want to use herbs? In my practice, I use herbs almost exclusively. Again, I'm trained in it. I know the herbs very well. I know what to expect. There's a lot of different herbal protocols out there. If you're new to this and you're not quite sure, of course, you can always buy my book and I outline it. But otherwise, you know, it's just understanding the principle of what the herbs are doing. And understand when you give an antibiotic, you know, antibiotics are designed to kind of do one thing, right? To kill the bug. And some of these antibiotics at higher doses are, you know, maybe a bit anti-inflammatory like doxycycline. But herbs are complex compounds. So often they do a lot of things. You know, when I can give, you know, one or two herbs, you know, not only are they antimicrobial, they're anti-inflammatory, they help promote better circulation, they help boost, you know, NK cell or T cell function. They, you know, they do all these other things. They're, you know, demulcent, they help soothe the GI tract. So we're getting a lot of different mechanisms when we're using herbs. So it gives us the possibility to really mix and match and find what's specific to our patient that their body needs. And if you understand the fundamentals about what these herbs are doing, it's really easy to, you know, put the right combination together that's going to work best for your patient. Now, a lot of these companies out there have already kind of done the homework for you, and they put together different combinations that you can just buy off the shelf and say, here, take this. You know, Lee Cowden put together a whole series of herbs and nutrients through Nutramedics, where, you know, he talks about month one, day one, here's what you do. Day two, he's got a whole book written out. This is exactly what you do. So you can give the book to your patient, give them the stuff, there you go. And they can follow it. And it's pretty straightforward. You know, other herbal protocols, you know, it's not written out quite the same way. But, you know, again, there are different protocols to help kind of, you know, mix and match and find what's right for your patient. But I think, you know, being able to target the organism, you know, we got to get the load down. There's this question that comes up, and it's a great question. I don't think we know the truth, is can we completely eradicate Lyme 100%? And the God's honest truth is I don't know. I don't think anyone knows. I think Borrelia is one of these organisms that, even though it's a bacteria, it behaves a bit more like a virus. So even though, you know, viruses like herpes viruses, once you get exposed, they're in you your whole life. You'll never get rid of them. Epstein-Barr, CMV, varicella, herpes 6, herpes 7, all of those, once they're in you, they're part of you. I kind of feel like Borrelia is the same way. And I've just seen enough patients over the years where, you know, we'll see relapses, usually when their immune system starts to tank. That would be consistent, much like, you know, you'll see shingles in someone who had chickenpox as a kid when their immune system tanks, because that virus is now allowed to become active. So that can and does happen. So I don't know that we completely eradicate Borrelia 100%, but I think we get to a point where we help people tolerate Borrelia so it doesn't bother them and vice versa. And if we can get to that point, you know, people can live symptom free. So whatever means we need to help get that control, you know, I'll use. And I think, you know, herbs are very effective at accomplishing that. And because we are getting all these other additional benefits of herbs outside of just killing the bug, that also helps balance out a lot of the side effects that you might get if you were using antibiotics alone. You know, I don't get a lot of, you know, die-off reaction from herbs, this Herxheimer reaction. I don't get a lot of gastrointestinal complaints. I don't have to worry about giving an antifungal at the same time as an antibiotic, because most of these herbs are naturally antifungal. Dr. Cowden had a great comment. He was talking about some of these herbs, and he kept saying, well, this one's a keep herb. This one's a keep herb. And finally, I'm like, I had to ask him, like, I don't know what you're talking about. What's a keep herb? He goes, well, it kills everything except people. So it means it kills bacteria, kills viruses, kills fungi, kills parasites, but it doesn't harm us. And a lot of these herbs do have that broad antimicrobial effect. So that's why I said a lot of when you're using herbs, you usually don't have to piggyback a secondary, you know, antifungal on top of it. But being able to target the organism, and this is where, you know, testing can be helpful. Is it Lyme? Is it Lyme and Bartonella? Is it Lyme, Bartonella, Babesia? Knowing what you're dealing with may help alter your combination. If you're going to use antibiotics, you really do need to know what you're dealing with, because some antibiotics work well for one infection and do absolutely nothing for the other. You know, I mean, you can give doxycycline all day long, and if you've got Babesia, it's going to do absolutely nothing. You know, you need azithromycin with Mepron or Malarone. So, you know, with antibiotics, you really have to know exactly what you're dealing with. With herbs, there's a bit more forgiveness because there is a lot more overlap with the herbs and the various co-infections. A lot of the herbs work on, you know, Lyme and Bartonella and Babesia. I will still alt them a little bit. I know with certain formulas, they happen to work better with one co-infection over another, but by and large, a lot of these herbs do overlap. So step three, again, just, you know, target the organism, make sure you're getting that load down, get it under control. I do not find that testing is helpful in monitoring how well your therapy is working. There's no biomarker, at least that I've been able to identify, that's reliable enough that we can use to monitor patients over time. So unfortunately, we rely on their subjective experience. And some patients are great at telling you that, others are horrible. And unfortunately, it's the nature of the beast, but CRP isn't reliable. Lyme antibody testing, once they have positive antibodies, the research suggests that you can have antibodies for up to 20 years after you've had exposure, even if you've been treated. So don't ever, ever, ever waste their money chasing antibodies. It means absolutely nothing, at least for Borrelia. For some of the other ones, yes. I do expect to see Bartonella antibodies go away, Babesia antibodies go away, Anaplasma antibodies go away. Borrelia, they will probably have at least IgG antibodies most, if not their entire life. So don't use that as a marker. But unfortunately, again, you just have to use the patient's subjective experience on how they're doing. So I alter my treatment based on how they tell me they're feeling. Step four is, I think, really looking at environmental triggers. Because a lot of folks, once they get exposed to Lyme, can become very sensitized, their world can start to affect them in a negative way. So again, whether it's chemicals they use around the home, things like Roundup, of course, which are horribly toxic, personal care products, makeup, shampoos, a lot of this conventional stuff, you know, if you read the ingredient label, I mean, there's a lot of chemicals in it. It's just one more thing, two more things, three more things that might undermine their immune system and make them worse. So let's clean the slate as much as possible. And again, these are things that don't cost people any extra money. Anybody can do it. I mean, I don't think it matters where you live in the world. You have access to cleaner products than probably what you're currently using. And again, it's just educating people on what those products are, where to go find clean, natural things that aren't going to work, you know, to undermine their immune system. So we talk about, you know, get rid of all the 409 and Tylex and Windex and all the garbage around the house. Go replace it with all the cleaner, more natural things that aren't going to be potentially harmful. Then it's about, you know, looking at other exposures in and around the home. Obviously, if they're smokers, they drink too much, make sure they're getting all that under control. And the big one here is mold. I have been surprised at how many Lyme patients I've worked with where we start down their treatment path, they get a little better, or maybe they don't get better at all. And then we come to find out that really mold was the underlying culprit. And especially for you guys up in the Bay Area, because you get a little bit more moisture than us down here in sunny Southern California, it can be a huge problem. And what I realize about construction in California is that it kind of sucks. The houses here are not built like they are on the East Coast, where they're built for weather. Here, they're not. They're just thrown up. They don't take the flashing up very high on the roof. I have a colleague down here that we had a bad rainstorm a couple of years ago where it was, you know, 50, 60 mile an hour winds. The rain came sideways and it basically flooded her house. And she ended up with $350,000 of damage to her very beautiful home in Corona del Mar because the flashing just didn't come up high enough. So construction, by and large, is not great in California. That just allows these houses to be kind of leaky. And when we do get rain and moisture, and certainly all these houses that are right on the beach, you know, I see so many patients from Laguna Beach, Newport Beach, Corona del Mar, where their houses are near the water and they're leaky houses and there's just moisture in the air. And over time, that moisture does accumulate and can start to cause mold problems. And certainly for anyone who's had a leaky roof, had a leaky faucet, leaky pipe somewhere in the home, that's the ideal circumstance where you can get, you know, mold exposure and ultimately mycotoxin exposure. And it's interesting, if you write down all the symptoms associated with Lyme disease, all the symptoms associated potentially with mycotoxicity, there's probably an 80-85% overlap. So, you know, clinically, it can be very difficult to distinguish one from the other. I'm at a point now where I just test all my patients I suspect of Lyme for mycotoxins right from the get-go. It's going to take us down a very different treatment path, but it's good to know if that's something that they're dealing with, because you don't want to waste time just dealing with Lyme when maybe it's Lyme and mold and mycotoxins. So I like to have that information right from the get-go. So I use either Great Plains Labs or Real-Time Labs for urine mycotoxin testing. Real-Time used to be a lot more expensive. I've heard they've recently dropped their price. They're a bit more competitive now. They're both good labs. They use different methodologies. Real-Time's been around longer in terms of their mycotoxin testing. But again, I've done both. I think they're both reliable. So it's dealer's choice on what lab you prefer. But I think getting an assay on what someone's body burden might look like with mycotoxins will be very helpful for you. Understanding that there may be some people who are very poor excretors, because we see this a lot when we test people for heavy metals. You know, we are quite confident from their clinical history that they've had heavy metal exposure, and we provoke them with, you know, well, it used to be DMPS, which is gone now, but DMSA or EDTA, we collect their urine over 6 hours and nothing comes out, nothing at all. Well, you know, it may be, well, it could be that they really don't have exposure, which we don't really think so based on their history, or they're just really poor excretors and they just can't get rid of it. Their body can't easily mobilize those metals away from the tissue. So for people who are poor excretors, sometimes they need a long-term treatment of, you know, a chelating agent to really start to mobilize it out of tissue. The same thing can happen with mycotoxins. People may need to stir up the pot a little bit to really mobilize enough of it out of tissue to get it back through the bloodstream, get it back into the bile so that we can eventually bind it up and then pull it out through the stool. So again, it's just, it's important to know because it's common. I'd say probably more than 60% of my Lyme patients, when we test them for mycotoxins, have some elevated level of mycotoxins that we have to deal with. And maybe it's 70%. I'm going to say 70%. It's a lot. So, you know, again, it's going to take you down a different treatment path. So get that done right away so that you can get them on the right process of that. Step five is really just about managing lifestyle. You know, I think when a lot of people get Lyme disease, they, for lack of a better word, let themselves go and they stop taking care of themselves. And so it's just an important reminder that, you know, we need them sleeping well. You know, the sleep is when you get in that deep restorative sleep, that's when your brain detoxifies. That's when your neurons get to repair themselves. That's when your tissue repairs itself. I'm a big fan of people using some sort of sleep monitoring device. I use personally an Oura Ring. Other people like the Fitbit. It doesn't really matter, whatever works for them and fits their budget, but it can be really helpful to know, are they sleeping as well as they might say they are, or they think they are? And sometimes they'll say, you know what, I sleep 8-9 hours, but I wake up, I'm exhausted. Well, okay, let's see kind of how bad it is. And I like having that data point to say, well, look, you're getting 20 minutes of deep sleep, you're getting an hour of REM sleep. You know, you need to be getting triple that. And as you start treating them, now you've got a way to actually not just go by their subjective experience, but also a data point that you can actually measure and monitor. And I find at least the Oura Ring is pretty accurate. I'm sure they're not perfect. None of these devices are. But over time, I think you'll get enough useful information to help guide your treatment in case you need to start tweaking it a little bit to get them deeper sleep. So making sure they're getting good, deep quality, high quality sleep, making sure that they're getting some sort of movement. Exercise is critically important for Lyme folks because they tend to not feel well, their body hurts, their pain, their joints hurt, and they tend not to do anything. And of course, the sedentary lifestyle can lead to all sorts of other metabolic and health issues. So, I find that people can do something. It may not seem like a lot, but there's always something you can do, no matter what your fitness level is. When I was in the throes of Lyme and I was exhausted and my joints hurt, I would literally plop in front of the couch and I just stretched. It didn't seem like very much, but it was still moving my blood, still moving my lymph, still getting me moving in some way. And as I felt a little better, then I would just walk around the house, and then I walked around the block, and then eventually got to a point where I started studying martial arts. So it may be a slow progressive process for people, but you've got to give them a place to start and just reminding them that doing something's better than doing nothing at all. So if their legs are weak, they can't walk, get their arms moving, get them just, get like little half pound dumbbells and sit on the couch and raise your arms. There's something they can do. So engage them in some sort of activity, gentle exercises like, yoga, Tai Chi, Qigong, stretching, swimming. There's a lot of things that people can do that really aren't high impact. We're not trying to get their heart rate up to 140, 150. We're just trying to get their body to move. And then the last thing is really helping them manage stress. Having any kind of chronic illness is stressful. It's stressful for them. It's stressful for their spouse, their kids, their friends. Everyone gets tired of hearing about it. So you may be that one outlet for them to de-stress, but you need to help them have tools that they can implement at home. And whether it's being in a group, whether it's working with a therapist, whether it's doing art, again, people just have to find what works for them. For me, it's just, I like to watch a really funny movie. I watch a lot of really funny movies. Laughter is the best medicine, right? So that works for me. But, talk with your patients and, have that honest conversation about how they feel about their illness. How are they managing their stress? How's their family managing it? And you can just save a lot of grief and time. I'm actually a really big fan of Annie Hopper's DNRS program, if you guys aren't familiar with that. It's Dynamic Neural Retraining System, and it's really about retraining your limbic system. And I find for a lot of my Lyme patients, they do remarkably well in that program. And with COVID-19, Annie used to do in-person events that were like 7 or 8 days. Now you can just, download the videos at home and people do it on their own. It does require discipline. Patients have to do these exercises every day, and it can take up to an hour to kind of go through these mental exercises. I mean, they're mental exercises, they're not physical exercises. But for the people who stick to the program, the overwhelming majority of people report that they're happier, they feel better, they're sleeping better. So it just takes a lot of that stress off the limbic system. And it's a great program. There's another program out there by, I'm forgetting his first name, it's Gupta. Gupta and Annie Hopper have very similar symptoms. And I know you can go on YouTube and type in his name, and he's got all of his videos, I think, on YouTube. But it's the same concept. It's just, how do you retrain the limbic system and get the brain to kind of quiet down a little bit? So, I really kind of use these 5 steps as a way of, guiding people on that path. And then beyond that, it just becomes very individual. What are all the other individual issues that you need to address? Again, do you need to go after those hormone problems? Do you have a menopausal woman who's, estrogen's, tanked, and now she's getting hot flashes? My menopausal women, when they have Lyme, can be really challenging, only in that I don't know what's menopause and what's Lyme. Symptom-wise, I get hot flashes, my brain, I can't remember anything. I'm like, okay. And, sometimes we have to balance their hormones out. And if they get better, we know it was hormonal. If they don't get better, well, then it's probably still Lyme, and we need to continue to work on that. So there's the art of practicing, right? We got to try things and see what works for our folks. And if it's not working, we need to try something different. And, all those other little, things that come up with people. But, I find that these principles can apply to anyone. And I know we're talking about Lyme disease, but I would do this for anyone that had, Epstein-Barr virus, parvovirus, any other kind of chronic infection. The goal is still the same. it's really about, you know, treating the terrain. We need the terrain to be functioning better. And the way we get that functioning better really is through diet and lifestyle. You know, all these other, you know, pills we use can help, you know, as a nice adjuvant to that. But really the way our body heals is by eating the right foods, eliminating properly, getting good sleep, you know, all these really, you know, fundamental things that, you know, we probably learned our first year in medical school or first year, wherever you trained in anything, just on, you know, getting well. So that's sort of the essence of, you know, kind of my approach to Lyme. And again, there's a lot of other nuances. We should get into the co-infections. You know, Bartonella looks a little bit different because Bartonella, you can get burning neuropathy. Bartonella, you can get these very classical, we call them tracks. They look like stretch marks. True stretch marks actually tend to correlate with changes in weight, either plus or minus. Obviously for women who get pregnant or someone, you know, gains, you know, 20, 30 pounds in a short period of time. And true stretch marks follow the skin folds. With Bartonella, what's really odd about them is that these are in people that have no change in weight. And they tend to be perpendicular to the folds of the skin. So when you start to see, you know, these quote stretch marks on the abdomen and they're going north, south, and not east, west, that's almost indicative of Bartonella. So a lot of the Bartonella tracks tend to be on the torso. Sometimes you'll see them on the shoulders or the arms, sometimes on the upper thigh. You'll rarely see them outside of those areas. But again, in a young person in particular with no history of weight loss or weight gain, that would be very unusual. They can look very dark purple like regular stretch marks. You'll find in the course of treating Bartonella that they will start to lighten up. That's a sign to me that it's getting better. Bartonella very much has a disposition to the vascular system. That's why it gets into these superficial capillaries and starts to damage them. And that's why you see these, you know, these stretch marks come out. Unfortunately, I've had some patients, even after successfully treating Bartonella, because it's damaged the soft tissue underneath it, it's almost like a scar. You'll see these residual clear marks on their skin that sometimes they go away if they're really young, sometimes they don't. I tell people if it's really bothering them, it's a cosmetic issue, you know, go see a plastic surgeon. There's probably something they can do to even the skin out. But at that point, it really is cosmetic and not functional. You know, Babesia is a little bit different. Babesia is a blood parasite. You get cyclical fevers, you know, almost like you see with malaria. They'll get fevers like every week. They get the fever, it goes away. They get the fever, it goes away. And they'll get this thing called air hunger where they feel like they just can't get a deep breath. You know, look at the shortness of breath. They're not asthmatic. Often they'll get tested for asthma. Everything looks fine, but they'll feel that need to want to take a deep breath. You know, that's kind of a hallmark of Babesia. Anaplasma, Ehrlichia, they both infect white blood cells. So often you'll see leukopenia, you'll see neutrophil count go down. That could be a hallmark of both. Otherwise, you know, you get symptoms that are very similar to Lyme disease. So with the co-infections, again, these little kind of interesting nuances that you just kind of learn with experience. But, you know, I think when you're testing people, I test for the gamut of everything I can. I think this least is most probable based on where we think their exposure occurred, where they live, the timing. That's a pretty good indicator about what type of things you run, but I'll test for, you know, Lyme, Bartonella, Babesia, Anaplasma, Ehrlichia, Mycoplasma, Rickettsia. They're all very common in the U.S. and clinically they can be difficult to distinguish. I see that there are some questions here in the chat. And let me come back here. Okay. Can you share the name of the most reliable Lyme test? Sure. Sorry, Lydia, this is privately, but I will answer it publicly. So I use a couple of different labs. My favorite lab is called Medical Diagnostic Labs. They're in Hamilton, New Jersey. The reason I like them is that they do a reliable Lyme testing and co-infection testing. And the best thing is they bill insurance. So there's some really great labs out there that don't bill insurance, and Lyme testing can be very expensive, but they bill pretty much every insurance company out there. And if you have a patient that doesn't have insurance, their cash pricing is actually very inexpensive. I also like MDL because at least with the Lyme Western blot, they send you a copy of the actual strip I was a microbiologist before I was a doctor. I used to do Lyme testing for a living, so I know exactly what I'm looking at, but you can look to see if they have those Lyme specific antibodies or not. So I like being able to see the strip. They're the only lab I know of that actually sends you a copy of the Lyme Western blot strip. So I use MDL. I like Igenex and Palo Alto. Igenex is a great lab. They do great testing. My only complaint is that outside of Medicare, they don't bill insurance. So it's just expensive for folks. I think MDL does as good testing as Igenex. And if insurance is going to pay, why give the patient one more out-of-pocket cost? There are some tests that Igenex does that MDL does not do. They do a Bartonella Western blot. They do a Babesia fish. They do a Borrelia miyamotoi test. So there's if I'm suspicious for a few other things, I will use Igenex just because MDL doesn't do it. You know, some of these things you probably could run through, you know, Quest, LabCorp, your local reference lab, you know, Bartonella, Babesia, Anaplasma, you could run it through it. I don't know that these other labs are superior. I tend to run through MDL because, again, insurance pays anyway. I trust them a little bit more than the local reference lab. But if you have a patient who's really strapped on cash, you can still run it through, you know, the reference lab. The Lyme is the one I would still use a specific lab that specializes in tick-borne testing. And whether it's Igenex or MDL, I would definitely, for the Lyme testing, at least use those labs. Is chronic Lyme an autoimmune disease or a persistent infection? It's both. And we know from Johns Hopkins research that, again, up to 20% of these organisms, the Borrelia organisms, were resistant to antibiotics. They're persisters. That's probably what creates the chronic Lyme situation. And then the longer it's there, it does tend to stimulate, you know, this autoimmune response. So the answer is really both. And that's why I think, again, as you think about everything you do for any other autoimmune patient, that's what we talked about, diet, you know, getting their gut under control. All that's important for any autoimmune disease, no matter what it is. And we're doing the same thing for our Lyme folks. Why do we hear about Lyme more now? Is it an increase? Or are we more aware of the issue, a diagnosis more frequently? Yeah, Brian, it's both. We get, CDC estimates are over 300,000 new cases a year. Now understand, that's new cases. That's keep adding that every year to the existing cases. We literally have millions and millions of people living with Lyme disease in the US, many of which do not realize that they've been infected. But it's becoming more frequent. Part of that is that the tick population continues to explode. Things that used to kill ticks, like, you know, cold winters out on the East Coast and the Midwest, they just don't get the cold winters like they used to. So that allows these ticks to survive the winter and then, you know, continue to populate. And then a lot of the natural predators of ticks, so opossums are actually natural predators of ticks. A lot of those natural predators, their population is diminishing. So between, you know, more ticks growing, less stuff killing the ticks, that allows them to go. Plus with, you know, climate change, birds are actually carrying a lot of these ticks away from their environment. There was a study done. They found that, you know, birds in the U.S., they will migrate as far as almost Alaska. That's a long way. So, you know, these people, you know, in the Midwest, they say, oh, we don't have Lyme disease in Missouri or Kansas. Well, you know what? You do. And, you know, birds may be carrying it from Connecticut to Kansas. And then if there's a tick that hitches a ride, that tick gets off after it gets there. And then, you know, now it can, you know, create its own little problem. So, yeah, I think it's a combination that, you know, people are more aware of it. Although there's still a huge controversy between, you know, I said IDSA and the ILADS folks about, does chronic Lyme exist? Even though we've got several studies showing it does, the IDSA says, no, it doesn't. That's why you just need to treat it for 2 or 3 weeks and you're fine, but it's not true. What blood tests determine what type of Lyme you have? Well, most of the blood testing out there, Justine, is actually for Borrelia burgdorferi. If you use Igenex, they do have testing that looks at the other species, particularly the European strain. So if you have a patient you suspect might have been infected in Europe, they look at Borrelia guarinii and Borrelia abzelii, but they also look at Borrelia miyamotoi, Borrelia hermsii, Borrelia elizabethae. You know, there's several strains that we are known to cause human disease. Igenex probably tests for most of the strains. I will typically test with MDL for Borrelia burgdorferi only because it's still the most common form. There's probably some cross-reactivity between the different Borrelia species. But yeah, if you're, you know, we know that up to half the cases in California specifically are Borrelia miyamotoi. So for my California people, I've been doing more and more Borrelia miyamotoi testing. I'm doing more of it, but ironically, I'm not getting as many positives as I was expecting, considering that we were told that, you know, up to half the cases are Borrelia miyamotoi. That's not been my experience yet. So I still do MDL as my initial testing. How about testing positive with Rocky Mountain spotted fever, IgM, in addition to Lyme? Yeah, I mean, Rocky Mountain spotted fever is a common co-infection. And in terms of what types of antibiotic would you use? So for Rocky Mountain spotted fever, typically we'll still use a combination of doxycycline or azithromycin with amoxicillin. You can also use rifampin. That works pretty well for both. So usually a combination of those two of the four. Can I share my Dr. Zhang herbal protocol for chronic Lyme? Sure. This is a combination. Dr. Zhang recently changed the names. So the ones I use as my sort of core formulas is Artemisia formula. It used to be called Artemisia 2. Now it's called ArtM. It's basically the same formula. I use a Hetunia formula. It's now called HHM. It used to be HH2. Circulation P. So the Artemisia and Hetunia formula are designed to target the organism. They're sort of our natural antimicrobial. Circulation P, as the name suggests, this is to help promote better circulation. It also helps break up immune complexes, which is part of that type 2 hypersensitivity of immune complex deposition, which can get into the blood vessels, other tissues. That's what causes potentially joint pain and just, you know, that decreased blood flow. So circulation P is good for that. AIM used to be called AI number 3. This is an anti-inflammatory formula. The thing with AIM, you have to be careful about your women who are premenopausal. They can't be on it longer than 3 or 4 months. You have to cycle them off because they can goof up their menstrual cycle. But other than that, it's fine. And then the last one, the fifth one, is called R5081M. And it is a combination of herbs that help. Part of it helps kill Lyme. Part of it also helps with adrenal function. It's got some herbs that are adaptogenic. So I like the adaptogenic property. And again, it's got a few other herbs to help kill Lyme. So those are the five formulas I'll use a lot for chronic Lyme. There are a few other formulas. There's a Poraria formula called Poraran Caps I'll use for my brain fog people. There is a one called Herbsom I'll use for people who have sleep problems. And then he's got a glyceriza formula, which is a licorice extract. If you've got someone who's also compounded with viruses, licorice is a very good antiviral. Is blot test reliable? I'm assuming you're referring to the Western blot. Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say it's not that it's not reliable. The problem with the Western blot test is that they do measure quantity of antibody. And the guidelines from the CDC is that you have to make at least 60% of the intensity of the control to call it positive. So what MDL does by sending you the strip, you can see those percentages and you'll see these people at 58%, 59%. It gets called negative. I'm like, really, 1%? I mean, that's you having, you know, a sip of water in between your blood draws. So this is the stupidity of testing that in 40 years of research, we've never changed that criteria. By the way, the test that's out there was never designed to be diagnostic, ever. If you go to the CDC's website and read about Lyme disease, it tells you it's based on signs and symptoms, and do you live in an area endemic for ticks? The lab test only can confirm your suspicion. So please, please, please don't ever use this lab test as a marker if someone does or does not have Lyme. I don't think I made that clear earlier, but let me make it clear now. Your diagnosis is clinical. It's based on their signs and symptoms. You do the lab test to try and prove yourself right, and you have to rule out everything else. So still do the ANAs and all the other, you know, tests to rule out autoimmune disease, run the CRP, rheumatoid factor, make sure there's not another explanation about why they feel the way they feel. But if all that's negative, you've got clinical history that suggests it, and if you've got evidence of Lyme-specific antibodies. So the Lyme-specific antibodies are 23, 34, 39 and 93. When you see one of those four, you know, in my world, you know, the CDC says, you know, you need 2 or 3 IgM antibodies or 5 or 10 IgG antibodies to call it positive. In my world, if I've got one Lyme specific antibody and they have clinical symptoms, I think it's relevant. You know, it's kind of like being a little pregnant, right? You are, or you aren't. So you have Lyme or you don't. So that's where I think it's important to look at those Lyme specific antibodies more than just all the rest of the stuff. So in a very long way, yes, the Western blots are reliable, but you have to know really kind of how to interpret it. If you're running it through Quest LabCorp general reference lab, it comes back negative. It may not really be negative, but again, don't rely on that as your marker about whether someone does or does not have Lyme disease. Is there any preparation a chronic Lyme patient should do before testing to get accurate results? No, it's not like you have to stir up the pot to get a reaction from them. There are some patients that I have seen had negative testing, had very weak antibody responses. Then after treatment were retested, they had a stronger antibody response. So yes, there are some people that will be more positive after you've treated them. So yeah, it's just... So you can do that. I don't routinely like provoke them before doing testing. I just test them when they're in the office. And if I'm suspicious they have Lyme, even if their test is negative, I treat clinically. I document in my note that Lyme is a clinical diagnosis according to the CDC. Lab tests are only there to confirm your diagnosis. Then here's the list of symptoms. So in case, I'm not an insurance provider, but if anyone ever audited my notes, I have an explanation about why I justified my treatment. I think if you are a medical doctor and you are treating with antibiotics and someone does not fit the classic value of Lyme, you have to be very careful. California is not a friendly state. If you are an MD or DO and you are treating with long-term antibiotics, just be very cautious. I'm a naturopath. I use herbs. I'm under the radar. But just understand that, you know, the conventional medical community is not a fan of using long-term antibiotics. Stephen, maybe you can clarify. You asked that. Please feel free to talk about cholesterol, just in random, just cholesterol in general. Oh, you're muted, Stephen.
You have a book and you talk about cholesterol.
Okay.
So I'm just inviting you to change the subject if we get to the end of the...
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I had a few other questions here. So yes. Someone asked about cryptolepis. So I use cryptolepis. Absolutely. Cryptolepis is a great herb. It's effective against Lyme, against Bartonella. And if you look at, there was an in vitro study that was done earlier this year out of Hopkins. They tested, it was 17 or 19 different herbs. I forget. And of those, cryptolepis, Japanese knotweed were two of the most highly effective against Borrelia. So again, I do use quite a bit of it and it works pretty well. Do herbs that heal Babesia have a similar effect as hydroxychloroquine on COVID-19? Is both going to have anti-malarial properties? You know, it's a great question. No one's studied it, so maybe. Yeah, I mean, you know, the herbs we use for Babesia, I mean, Artemisia is my favorite herb for Babesia. I mean, they've been using Artemisia to treat malaria in Africa for decades. And since Babesia shares a lot of similar properties as Plasmodium, we can use Artemisia. I have not used, like I said, I've had one COVID-19 patient. So I understand my COVID-19 experience is actually pretty thin here. So I end up going, this is at the time when hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, zinc was like hot. And I had talked to some of my colleagues like, oh my gosh, it's working so great. And this poor guy was really suffering. So I tried it on him and he responded great. I didn't have to do more. And what herbs, supplements do you use for sensitive patients, herxing, poorly tolerating diet from herbal? So if you're going to use herbs, Violet, I like to use some sort of tincture, only because I can control the dose much better than when I'm dealing with capsules. The increments between capsules is much greater. With, you know, herb tinctures, you can use, you know, drop doses. And I will do that. If I'm using Nutramedics or Beyond Balance or Byron White, all these are tinctures. Nutramedics and Byron White are alcohol-based. Beyond Balance is in glycerin. So if you have someone who's really sensitive and you want to use a glycerin base, you might want to use the Beyond Balance products. And I'll start with one drop a day. And every 2 or 3 days, as they tolerate, will go up by one drop a day. So it may take a little bit of time to get to their peak dose, but I'd much rather do it that way versus, you know, giving them a high dose, blast them out of the water, having them get a massive die-off, because it's hard to clean up the mess once they get that kind of herxing. Now, there's a lot of ways we can manage herxing. We can manage it through, you know, using Alka-Seltzer Gold. We can manage it through Tri-Salt, which is a combination of sodium, potassium, calcium bicarbonate. We can manage it. A lot of the different herbal companies have a detox formula. They can just take it more frequently. It's really about getting them to detox more readily that helps the die-off reaction. So there's a lot of ways to help manage that if you need to. But for my really sensitive patients, just go really slow and slow. Don't worry about getting them to their peak dose quickly. I'd rather take my time and make sure they tolerate it first before advancing their dose. I know the main factor with hydroxychloroquine in treatment of COVID-19 is it helps load zinc into the lungs, which blocks COVID receptor sites. I believe that's true. I don't disagree with you. I think that was just a statement. I'm not sure if you're asking about the herbs, if they have a similar mechanism. I don't know that the herbs have a similar mechanism as hydroxychloroquine. It's possible, but they've not really been studied in that way. So I don't know for sure. And on a completely different topic, hey, let's talk about cholesterol, right? Well, look, I wrote this book about treating high cholesterol naturally in 1999. So this is literally now a 20-year-old book. But the information in it hasn't drastically changed. And I think maybe just kind of hit the keys of managing cholesterol. You know, first understand cholesterol is completely synthesized in the liver. Dietary cholesterol has very little impact on blood cholesterol. So this whole nonsense of, you know, what goes on in diet with cholesterol, that if your cardiologist is still telling you, well, you need to go on a low-fat diet, you know, they need to read. That's nonsense. We learned a long time ago that high fat diet has zero impact. Honest to God, they did a study. They gave people, you're going to love this, 10 eggs a day, 10 eggs a day. I think it was for 6 weeks. And you know how much it lays cholesterol? Zero, nada, none yet. So, you know, dietary cholesterol, you know, the study showed that you probably only absorb about 10% of your dietary cholesterol. Remember, cholesterol is a huge molecule, right? Your body has to break that down to absorb it. We absorb very little actual cholesterol across the gut wall, maybe 10%. So, yeah, you don't have to worry too much about their cholesterol in their diet. I have seen more patients have problems with sugar. If you go back into biochemistry, there is a backward pathway in which your body can convert sugar into cholesterol. So people who eat a lot of refined sugar may be at higher risk. I think it's also metabolically what sugar does in the liver. And again, you have to go back into all the pathways of, you know, sugar being stored as glycogen. And then that does something ultimately to cholesterol synthesis. And I haven't taken biochem in a long time, but there's a pathway there and I'm forgetting it. But again, yeah, the dietary cholesterol has very little impact. So, you know, for the people who have familial hypercholesterolemia, I know that, again, this is a genetic condition, you can still manage them. I think a lot of, you know, what gets cholesterol down is really treating the liver. And I find when I improve their detox pathways, open up phase one and phase two, that as that improves, their cholesterol starts to go down. Get them off refined sugar. That tends to get their cholesterol to go down. There are some certainly, you know, herbs that help manage cholesterol. You know, red yeast rice is probably the one I've used the most. And of course, all the statin drugs, if you guys don't know the history, this came from red yeast rice. The very first statin drug was Mevacor that came out back in 1987. And red yeast rice is found to have 11 naturally occurring statin compounds. So Merck learned about this. They turned around, they took one of those compounds, of course, synthesized it, made it into a drug. And what's really interesting, I'm forgetting the company, I want to say it was Pharmanex, that made the first red yeast rice product. So Merck comes out with Mevacor, then they turn around and sued the supplement company for patent infringement. I can't make this stuff up, folks. So it ends up, it went to the appeals court, and I think it was Pharmanex. They end up winning on appeal. It's like, no, you can't steal from Mother Nature and sue Mother Nature. Mother Nature had it first. But, you know, red yeast rice does have 11 naturally occurring statin compounds in it. So it is an HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor, like, you know, the statin drugs. But, you know, you don't get all the side effects that you get with statin drugs. You don't have to worry about rhabdomyolysis, which can happen with statins. You know, statin drugs deplete CoQ10 from the body, which is probably why people get all the side effects. So if you've got patients on statins, you absolutely want them on CoQ10, probably no less than 200 milligrams a day if they're an adult. With red yeast rice, I usually will give a little CoQ10, at least 100 milligrams. I don't think it's necessary. It doesn't block HMG-CoA reductase quite the same way that the drugs do. But just to err on the side of caution. So red yeast rice works really quite well. There was some initial research on polycostanol. That was an extract of sugar cane. I used it for a while. I never found it was great. There's some new research coming out on bergamot, and there's a few new companies that have a unique bergamot extract that seems to be working quite well at managing lipids. Google lipid actually is quite helpful at managing cholesterol. Now, understand when I'm saying helpful, for a lot of these folks with the herbs, you're probably talking anywhere from a 7 to 15% reduction in total cholesterol. So if their total cholesterol is 600, you know, they probably need a drug. But if it's running, you know, 230, 250, 280, even around 300, I'll treat them naturally. You know, I know the cardiologists are now on this kick of wanting to get your cholesterol like ridiculously low, like in the low hundreds. Remember, the cholesterol is a backbone for all your steroid hormones. So if you want like testosterone and estrogen and cortisol, you probably want a little bit of cholesterol. And the other thing that's a little bit scary is that some of the new research is showing that the lower your cholesterol, your higher risk of, you know, neurological problems like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and so forth. So I'm cool with keeping cholesterol between about 160 and 240. I think looking at your ratio of HDL to LDL is helpful. Remember, with every 1 point increase in HDL, there's a 2% reduction in risk of cardiovascular events. For every 1 point increase in LDL, there's a 1% increased risk. So really, HDL outpaces LDL 2 to 1. So I have some patients that come in, usually women, their total cholesterol is 240, but their HDL is over 100. So their total cholesterol to HDL ratio is fantastic. You know, we want to see that total cholesterol to HDL ratio under 4. I think under 4 is good. Under 3 is a lot better. So you can do the math. I know a lot of the reference labs, they do the math for you. They'll show you the total cholesterol to HDL ratio. If they don't, then pull out the calculator, do it yourself. But that's a pretty good measurement. And, you know, beyond that, we now know that particle size is probably the most important. You know, I think of cholesterol like the gun. You know, the gun by itself is not inherently dangerous. Someone needs to buy the gun, buy the bullets, load the gun, point the gun, shoot the gun, hit the target, blah, blah, blah. All these things have to happen to make the gun dangerous. Cholesterol is the same way. Cholesterol by itself is not dangerous at all. You know, cholesterol has to get oxidized. You know, the particle size makes a difference. So, you know, when I do cholesterol profiles, I try and get away from doing the standard, you know, total cholesterol, HDL, LDL, trigs. It doesn't tell you the whole picture. You know, doing the NMR and I think, you know, Boston Heart or Cleveland Heart merged with Quest, and they can do their whole profile, looks at particle size, looks at lipoprotein A, looks at ApoE. You know, you want to look at all these other genetic markers as well to see what someone's true cardiovascular risk is. And I don't think you get a complete assessment just through measuring the standard lipid profile on a reference lab. But again, all these other herbs, diet, exercise, lifestyle things, of course, smoking, drinking, all these things increase their cardiovascular risk. So tell them not to do that. Let's see, what else about cholesterol that's interesting? Garlic's another great way to help keep cholesterol in check. Garlic also is a natural blood thinner. Now, you're not going to bleed out by eating a ton of garlic, but then, you know, same thing with fish oil and vitamin E. If you guys have ever been told you need to stop fish oil and vitamin E before surgery because you're going to bleed out, these doctors don't freaking read. It's not true. The amount of fish oil and vitamin E you have to take is so astronomically high. Nobody does that. I mean, I tell patients to stop the day before surgery to make the surgeon happy, but in reality, they would probably recover a lot faster if they were on those nutrients because they're anti-inflammatory. But yeah, in terms of, you know, cholesterol, anything that, you know, can help mildly thin the blood, you know, that's a very mild platelet aggregator. If you did a bleeding time on someone, PT, PTT, they're all going to look perfectly normal for someone who eats, you know, a bulb of garlic a day. But again, it's something that people can incorporate into their diet. The very first book I wrote was actually called Garlic and Cholesterol. And then they decided to expand it and called, you know, Natural Treatment of High Cholesterol. Yet most of the books still talked about garlic. So again, garlic's very modest, you know, 7 to 10% reduction in total cholesterol, slightly raises HDL, lowers LDL. I think red yeast rice works a lot better, as does bergamot. Let's see.
I think we're at the end of the questions. Anybody want to raise your hand?
I got one more question from Violet here. She says, can you please talk about some of your favorite best natural formulas for chronic infection common to chronic fatigue syndrome for those patients without Lyme? and co-infection, CMV, Epstein-Barr, blah, blah. Please speak slower, taking notes. I will talk slower. Sorry about that, Violet.
I know there's a time crunch.
So yeah, my favorite things for chronic infection, my general chronic infection protocol, I'm a big fan, of course, of vitamin C. So vitamin C for an adult, I'm assuming this is an adult, 1,000 milligrams three times a day, at least. You can use higher doses if they tolerate. I'll give Isla a chance to write. Number two is vitamin A. And when I talk about vitamin A, I mean vitamin A. Vitamin A palmitate, not beta carotene. Understand that vitamin A and beta carotene are not the same thing. Beta carotene is technically two vitamin A molecules joined together. Our body only converts maybe 10 to 20% of that beta carotene to vitamin A. So I want to use pure vitamin A palmitate. And I'll use 25,000 IUs a day on up. Now, with vitamin A, you can get toxicity. However, it's unlikely to happen unless they're on really long term. So for short term, saying probably weeks to maybe a month or two, it's probably pretty safe. 25,000 IUs a day is very safe. If you get up to 50, 75,000 IUs a day, you probably want to monitor your folks, check their liver enzymes. You know, vitamin A toxicity can cause headaches, joint pain, fatigue, dry skin and liver issues. I have never seen any of that in any of my patients. I've given 250,000 IUs to teenagers for acne for over a year and never seen a problem. But I do warn people about it just in case. And that's one of those cover your ass things legally documented in your chart. So vitamin C, vitamin A, vitamin D. Of course, vitamin D is a hormone, right? It's not really a vitamin. So 5 to 10,000 IUs a day for an adult with food. It's an immune modulator. Zinc 30 to 50 milligrams a day. Again, you can use higher doses if you feel like your patients need it, or if you've ever tested them, find out they're zinc deficient, give them a higher dose. Make sure they take their zinc with food. Zinc on empty stomach will make you horribly nauseous. If you want to make someone really unhappy, have them take zinc on empty stomach. So those are kind of the nutritional things. And then in terms of chronic infection, I guess it really, for me at that point, depends on what I think I'm treating. If I think I'm treating a virus, I will probably use herbs that I know are antiviral. And whether that's olive leaf extract, whether that's elderberry, whether that's lomatium, there's a lot of great herbs. I use a lot of andrographis. Andrographis, I think, I wish they had studied it for COVID-19. I'd bet my bottom dollar it's probably highly effective against COVID-19. So I use a lot of andrographis for viral illness. And if it's a bacterial infection, again, I might use more herbs that are more antibacterial. I might use things like berberine, golden seal, astragalus. Yeah, so I apologize. I know it's kind of vague. I know that, but those nutrients are kind of the core. And then again, I think other herbs can be added in really as needed. Someone just made a comment that Klinghart recommended andrographis for COVID. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. It's a pretty well-established antiviral herb. All right, well, I think that's the end of the questions, unless there's other things that people are burning to know.
We have no hands raised.
I see Molly's raising her hand there. Is there a way to unmute her?
I can ask her to unmute.
Oh.
There you go.
Wait.
Okay.
Like this?
You're unmuted.
Oh, wait, that's the wrong person. Wait, sorry.
Molly, we can hear you.
Oh, you can hear, okay. Yeah. I've always been afraid to take red rice yeast because I thought it might cause yeast infection,
Yeah, so the way red yeast rice is made is they take rice and they sprinkle this yeast on it and it ferments. It's basically a fermented food, but no, it doesn't put you at risk of getting a yeast infection.
Okay, what if you have some yeast infection and you don't know you have it, would it make that worse?
Nope, it has nothing to do with yeast infections at all.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah, thank you.
No, perfectly fine.
And by the way, I have your book.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm reading it. I bought it after I found out you were going to be speaking.
Oh, wonderful. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Last call?
I see a hand raised. I'm going to, I don't see her name, but I see someone waving in the camera.
Yes, hi. Yeah.
Oh, Jennifer. Hi, Jennifer.
Hi there. Thank you. I wanted to know if you've ever dealt with vision challenges with treating Lyme patients, whether their vision gets less acute.
Yeah, I mean, it's a fairly common problem with Lyme, and it varies. Sometimes it's blurry vision, sometimes it's double vision, sometimes it's dim vision. It really kind of depends on how it's manifesting. I am always extra cautious because Lyme does have this association with MS and other types of demyelinating issues. If it's a chronic visual regression, I will usually send people in for an MRI just to make sure there's not some sort of demyelinating process going on. And barring that, if everything comes back and it looks fine, then it's just a function really of treating Lyme. And I've had people that complain of vision and or hearing problems that get better. You know, some people complain of terrible tinnitus with Lyme. And then as they treat Lyme, their vision gets better, their hearing gets better, the tinnitus goes down. So that's just a function of getting Lyme under control, if that's their cause.
Okay, thank you.
If anybody's on a cell phone, you can unmute
Hello?
Yourself and ask a question.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Good.
Hi. Yes. So I have restless leg syndrome, and somebody thought, I don't know if it was from parasites. And I did have a stool test like a while ago, and they said they did find like an amoeba in there. Is that related with restless leg with parasites, you think?
I have not seen restless leg specifically with parasites. Restless leg syndrome, if you look at least at the literature, tends to be associated with iron deficiency is very common, particularly for women. Vitamin E deficiency can cause restless legs. So usually I'll start women on iron. You know, have more iron in your diet, and you know, check your ferritin level. If your ferritin's below 50, that may mean that you need more iron. Forget the reference range on the labs. The labs go down to 10. If you're 10, you need iron. So iron deficiency, vitamin E deficiency, I'll start supplementing with both. And then beyond that, it can be sometimes neurologic. So for someone certainly with Lyme disease, sometimes restless legs is a neurological problem or a circulation issue. So I'll use like Dr. Zhang's circulation P. I'll use
Excuse me, I'm sorry, can I write that down? What is this, doctor?
Yeah, Dr. Zhang is the doctor.
Zhang, can you spell that, please?
It's in the chat window. So if you save your chat, you'll see it there.
Oh, I'm on the phone though, but I guess.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's okay. It's a Z-H-A-N-G.
Okay, Dr. Zhang.
And he has a formula called Circulation P.
Circulation P, okay.
And it's really designed to help promote better circulation, helps break up immune complexes. And I use that a lot for restless legs.
Have you found that vitamin C, by improving vegetarian iron absorption, works comparably?
Well, vitamin C does help with iron absorption. So if, you know, I mean, heme iron, unfortunately, from animal sources is a much better absorbable form of iron. And if you're a vegetarian and you're getting most of your iron from dark green leafy vegetables, nuts and seeds, you definitely want to make sure that you're getting enough vitamin C. If you're vegetarian or vegan, though, you have to be very careful about soy. Because a lot of people use soy as their primary protein, and soy actually blocks the absorption of iron. So if you're a heavy soy consumer and you're iron deficient, you're going to have a hard time overcoming that staying on soy.
So what should we eat? What do you suggest for iron? I'm a meat eater. More meat,
yeah,
liver.
So get a nice, juicy, bloody steak.
Or liver.
Or
oh,
liver.
Yeah.
Yeah, organ meats are very high in iron. But yeah, you definitely, unfortunately, yeah, heme iron is just a better absorbable form. And again, a little bit of vitamin C helps that. So even when people take iron as a supplement, I'll have them take vitamin C at the same time just to improve the absorption.
Vitamin C.
Yeah, calcium, tea, soy, and coffee all block the absorption of iron. So any iron that's taken in and around the same time as taking those, there's a good chance the iron won't get absorbed.
You were saying tea? I'm sorry, tea?
Tea.
Like, I have like herbal peppermint and chamomile. Would that be?
This is like a black tea, oolong
black.
Tea, green tea. Yeah.
Okay, black or green we shouldn't have, I guess.
Black, green, or, well, at the same time as iron. If it's taken away from iron, it's fine. But I have some people who take their, you know, their iron supplement with their green tea. That's counterproductive. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Or they'll take their iron with their multivitamin that has calcium in it. That's counterproductive.
Oh, that okay. Kind of iron and calcium. Yeah. Can I ask something else, or you probably have to go, right?
Sure. Go ahead.
I also have, I was told years ago, I have, well, the problem is I have a root canal that's affecting the thyroid, and it's associated with the teeth, you know, the tooth with the thyroid. I also have, unfortunately, fillings, silver fillings, and I also have, I think, an infection. I've been using oregano oil. Is there anything you can suggest for kind of, you know, people with, like, bad teeth or
well,
whatever?
It depends on how deep the infection is. My concern for people with bad teeth is that you're at a higher risk of cavitations. If that gets into the jawbone, that's a whole different ball of wax. And there are biological dentists that specialize in cavitation surgery. So I think if it's really just sort of a gingivitis where the damage is at the gum level, yeah, I mean, you can use oregano oil. Coconut oil is actually highly effective. Manuka honey is actually very effective. I've used different rinses with, you know, cat's claw, berberine, you know, any of these natural antimicrobials. Silver hydrosol works really well. But the problem may be of getting it to the deeper pockets where the infection might be hiding. Someone just put ozone. Yeah, ozone is brilliant, works really well because it's a gas. It'll get in all those cracks and crevices. I will say, though, and my dentist friends who are special to this will tell you that sometimes ozone will not get down to the deeper cavitation. So depending on how far down it is, and again, I'm not an expert in this, but.
What is ozone?
Ozone is a gas.
Oh.
So a lot of biological dentists will use ozone to treat various dental problems because it's a gas. It can get into the small cracks and crevices. And someone just commented here that cavitation and trigeminal neuralgia treated with ozone, drilled it into the bone. Yeah, sometimes you have to go right into the area and put the ozone. It sounds worse than it is. But I've had patients who've had the cavitation surgery, but I've had chronic Lyme patients where they didn't really get better until they had their cavitations taken care of. It was that jaw infection that was really perpetuating their illness. And yeah, it's good to, if that's something that, you know, you're suspicious of, yeah, ozone, it's a very, you know, it's a very powerful antiseptic. It's, you know, somewhat regenerative. And so it does a lot of different good things for the body. And again, I know at least down here in Orange County, a lot of the biological dentists use ozone, but you still need a oral surgeon who's specialized in cavitation surgery, because most dentists really overlook it. They don't know what they're looking for. Your standard dental x-ray, as far as I understand, doesn't really pick up these cavitations. So you need a special kind of x-ray to do that. And
I heard the 3D is the only thing that would, I'm having a panoramic x-ray next week, but I heard the 3D is the one that would show with the jaw. I don't know if that's true or not.
You know, that may be, yeah, it's not my area of expertise. If there's any biological dentists online here that can chime in on that. Steve says here, cone beam x-ray will find them. So, yeah.
I'm sorry, cone?
Cone beam.
Cone beam.
Yeah, it's a type of x-ray.
Cone beam x-ray.
It's a 3D kind of x-ray.
Yeah.
Oh, a 3D. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So I see someone else asked here, Jennifer is asking, have you ever seen idiopathic subglottic stenosis in your Lyme patients? I am sorry, Jennifer, I have not. I've not seen that. Client with chronic fatigue, insomnia, slow healing depression, indicative of Lyme, certainly can be. I understand Lyme can very much, and any of these tick-borne illnesses can very much cause a neuropsychiatric event. I've seen depression. I've seen suicidal ideation. I've seen schizophrenia. I've seen bipolar, especially if it's relatively acute. You know, people don't just overnight become, you know, schizophrenic or bipolar. I see this a lot in my children that have PANS, you know, pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric syndrome. So all of that can be a manifestation of Lyme. So yeah, I'd be suspicious. And if you've ruled out other possibilities, I would definitely want to look into that. I'm sorry, did I see another hand raise there?
Molly. Molly, can you unmute yourself?
There we go. Does it work down here?
No, you got it. We're hearing you.
Oh, I don't know what I did, but I want to know about, I don't see well at night. I used to be able to see well at night and now I can't. And so I can't drive on the freeway at night. And I'm very cautious driving at night. So
night vision changes, night blindness. You know, the best thing is a lot of carotenoids. They help with the pigmentation of the eye. They help with, you know, improving the integrity of the retina. So that's a combination of like all your orange, yellow vegetables, eating lots of those. Beta carotene can definitely help that. I've actually had people take enough beta carotene, their palms turn orange. It's not dangerous. Oh, really? It's called keratinemia, because beta carotene will deposit in tissue, but getting high levels of beta carotene.
How much beta carotene?
Oh, you probably want 200, 250,000 IUs a day. It's a lot.
Where can I get that? Because that beta carotene is hard to get.
Well, you can get it through food by eating all those orange pigmented foods. So you get them through carrots, you can get through pumpkin, you can get through squash, and you know, all the different squashes. You might want to take a supplement.
I took bilberry for at least a year. It didn't make any difference.
Yeah, bilberry is okay. I would probably look at something like lutein.
I'm taking that now.
Yeah, lutein and zeaxanthin. Those two flavonoids. Yeah. So again, it's not between that and adding the other carotenoids, that at least gives your vision a better chance of functioning better at night.
Okay, so you mean foods, but what about the pills? I mean, what about the supplement?
You can buy beta carotene supplements.
Where do I get it? And do I take 250,000?
Well, you can buy them in a health food store.
At that amount, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you can Whole Foods, Mother's, I don't know, wherever you've got in your local area. And it depends on the dose in there. But when I have people who are supplementing, usually they'll take about 200,000 IUs of beta carotene.
And it's not harmful, right?
No, if you get a lot, you'll turn orange.
Okay.
You'll look like Donald Trump.
Yeah, that's okay with me. You can make me chill. I'll go. That's okay. Never mind. But yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Any other questions? Let's see. Let me go down to the chat. Basically, Violet has a question here. Are there specific viral and bacterial infections you see that commonly cause light sensitivity, sound sensitivity? Well, you know, there's a lot, unfortunately. Lyme is definitely in any of the tick-borne illnesses, because they affect the brain. Anything that causes neural inflammation potentially can cause that sensitivity to light, sound, even sometimes affects taste. So Lyme, Bartonella, Anaplasma, Babesia, I think a lot of the viruses, some of the herpes viruses like Epstein-Barr, human herpes 6, any of them potentially can do it. So I'll do testing for people and try and figure out, you know, what organisms I think might be causing the problems. And again, based on that, you know, that kind of tells me what, you know, we need to do to treat it.
Yeah, there are some other photosensitizing agents, like taking too much B2 might give you photosensitivity.
Or St. John's wort.
Yeah, hypericin and pseudohypericin.
You know, it's funny with St. John's, you know, when all the research came out, and I don't know, maybe it was the 90s, late 90s, I forget, with St. John's wort, you know, antidepressive, great, blah, blah, blah. And then you start doing the research on St. John's wort and you realize it interferes with a ton of stuff. It really gunks up your liver. I got to be honest, I have not used St. John's wort in almost 15 years, I think it helps mildly with depression. It interferes with so many other things. It gums up a lot of the cytochrome P450 system that I've really gotten away from it. And honestly, I think there's better things that work for depression. I don't know, maybe that's another night's topic, but yeah, I don't really like St. John's wort much anymore. Good. Any other questions? Comments, snide remarks?
Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, my pleasure. I appreciate you having me. And
we do have one more question.
Sorry. What do you, for sleeping, somebody said, and I heard it wasn't necessarily good, melatonin. What do you suggest? And I tried passion flower extract. That's not helping. Do you have any natural things?
Well, for sleep, it depends if you're talking about falling asleep or staying asleep or both.
Both.
So melatonin's really only for falling asleep. Melatonin won't do a whole lot for you for staying asleep. So when the primary problem is falling asleep, melatonin can be helpful. If it's a problem with both, passion flower, passiflora can help.
May depend on your dose.
I find with a lot of the herbs that we use for sleep, you got to take quite a bit of them. It also depends on why you're not sleeping. Is it a cortisol issue? Is it stress? Can you not turn your brain off?
Yes.
So if you can't turn your brain off, one of my favorite things is actually homeopathic caffeia cruda. It's homeopathic coffee.
Oh.
Yeah. And you can use a 30C potency and just take like 3 or 4 pellets before you go to bed. Kind of helps quiet the brain and just allows you to sleep a little bit better. I also like theanine. Theanine is an extract of the green tea plant. Theanine is a natural sort of anxiety supplement. And I'll have people take, 200 to 400 milligrams at bedtime.
200 to 400 milligrams. Okay.
And glycine sometimes work. Glycine, you can take 3,000 to 6,000 milligrams. Glycine
I'm sorry. Okay. Glycine. Okay.
So 3,000 to 6,000 milligrams at bedtime. It usually comes as a powder. And just mix it in. So glycine actually helps raise your GABA.
Oh, okay. I was taking GABA years ago. Glycine. Okay.
Dr. Ingels, what's your experience with either calcium or magnesium? I found some people will get sedative actions from one and excitatory actions from the other, and that people seem to come on both sides of that spectrum.
Yeah, I probably see more benefit from magnesium. Now, magnesium is used in every metabolic pathway in your body. It's a natural, like an anxiolytic. I find it helps with sleep. Some people do okay with calcium. I tend to use calcium more in people where, not only are they having problems falling asleep, getting a lot of leg cramps, maybe sign of mineral deficiency. But I probably find magnesium works better than calcium 10 to 1. Someone asked about the homeopathic sleep remedy. It's caffeia cruda. So it looks like coffee, C-O-F-F-E-E-A. There's an A at the end of it. And cruda, C-R-U-D-A. It's just crude coffee and homeopathic coffee, 30C potency. If the health food store doesn't have 30C, if they have a different potency, it should still work. Just taking 3 or 4 little pellets at bedtime. And it's really for the people who can't turn their brain off. That's why they don't sleep. There's a million reasons people don't sleep, but for the people that can't turn their brain off, that's one of them. Okay, now I think we're done.
Great session. Thank you. Been lovely. Thank you so much.
All right, guys. Thanks so much. Have a great evening.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.